Good evening. Tonight, when we sing the hymns, the opening hymn we will stand for, but all the other hymns we will remain seated. I don't want it to look like Methodist at calisthenics tonight. So, last night we remembered Jesus as he shared his final meal with his family and friends. We remembered his words about a body broken and blood sacrifice. We remembered as Jesus led us to the garden to pray and that there could be another way beyond the violence to come while his disciples slept. We remember that Jesus was betrayed by the one whom he loved and arrested. We remember that the disciples ran away and their denial. We remember that Jesus stood before the chief priests and the Sanhedrin and how many were paid to testify falsely against him. Pilate questioned Jesus, "Are you the Son of God?" He answered, "You say that I am." Tonight we shall remember Jesus as he suffers the worst humanity can offer. Tonight we remember the cost of the grace God has extended to all of humanity. Tonight we will remember the depth of passionate love Jesus has for you and for me. The ancient practice of stripping the Lord's table and sanctuary at the end of the service is a vivid and dramatic way of showing the desolation and abandonment of a long night in Gethsemane and all that followed. Designated persons will pick up the cloths and the things upon the Lord's table and the candlesticks and the decorations, and they will quietly carry them out of the sanctuary. Then some others will come in and we will drape it all in black. This will be done in silence at the conclusion of the worship. We ask that you remain seated in silence as this is completed. And when done, the ushers will invite you to stand, and you are welcome to approach the rail and kneel in prayer, or you may just exit the sanctuary. Let us set our hearts for the story of Good Friday.
Thank you. Let us remember Jesus, who, though rich, became poor and dwelt among us, who was mighty indeed, healing the sick and the troubled, who, as a teacher to his disciples, was their companion and servant. May we ever be grateful for Jesus Christ and what he did for us. Let us remember Jesus, who prayed for the forgiveness of those who respected him and for the perfecting of those who received him, who loved all people and prayed for them, even if they denied and rejected him, who healed and sinned because he knew the cost of pride and selfishness, of guilty and hatred, both to people and to God.
May we ever be grateful for Jesus Christ and what he has done for us.
Let us remember Jesus, who humbled himself, obedient unto the cross. God has exalted him, who has redeemed us from the bondage of sin and give us new freedom.
May we ever be grateful for Jesus the Christ and what he has done for us and continues so to us.
Let us pray. Jesus, as you taught, so now we pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Jesus before Pilate. Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payments of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Messiah, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to chief priests in the crowd, "I feel I have no basis for charge against this man." But they insisted, "He stirs up the people all over by Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here." On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time.
Thank you. Jesus before Herod. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform a sign of some sort. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies.
Jesus returns to Pilate. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence, and I have found no basis for your charges against him. And neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him."
Thank you. Barabbas for Jesus. But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into prison for the insurrection in the city and for murder. Awaiting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore I will have him punished and then release him." But the loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will.
To deny Jesus is who he said he is to deny, is to cry, "Crucify." Creator, Son of God, the way of salvation, servant, savior, friend. To deny Jesus is who he said he is to cry, "Crucify." To fail to acknowledge Jesus before others is to cry, "Crucify." Those who would judge, those who would ridicule, those who seek grace, those who are broken, those on the fringe, those in need of who need hope. To fail to acknowledge Jesus before others is to cry, "Crucify." To reject Jesus' sovereignty of your life, not to allow Jesus to love others through you, is to cry, "Crucify." So to reject the hungry, the thirsty, those in need of acceptance, the cold or those in need of clothes, homeless, those who are imprisoned by law or by circumstances or perhaps even addictions. To reject Jesus' sovereignty in your life, not to allow Jesus to love others through you, is to cry, "Crucify." Hypocrisy, to claim Jesus as Lord and Savior, but to live a worldly witness, is to cry, "Crucify." Greed, power, jealousy, lust, pride, ego, moral relativism. Jesus really didn't mean that for me, did he? Or perhaps even selfishness. Hypocrisy, to claim Jesus as Lord and Savior, but to live a worldly witness, is to cry, "Crucify." And so all shout, "Crucify."
Crucify.
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 the troubled walk. As the soldiers led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.'"
Accepting our shame. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him, which read, "This is the King of the Jews."
the condemned. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminals rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, since you are under the same sentence, "we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
Filled with sin, condemned for his crime, hangs awaiting his doom next to the divine. Something special happens as he sees Jesus' face, confronting his life's brokenness, understanding his need for grace. Another criminal hangs there, not ashamed of his deeds, shouting angry insults at the Lord. Only for himself he pleads. The first man confronts him, "We hang justly, the law has had its way." But this man is truly innocent. For him there is no justice today. Then he turned to Jesus, "Is it true you are God's own son? What are you doing here? This is not the place for the Holy One." "Jesus, remember me," he said, as he looked into the Savior's eyes. Jesus loved him unconditionally and said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." No baptism, no repentant prayer, just the pain on this man's face for Jesus to know his heart and give him the gift of grace. Jesus, Jesus' death. It was about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, for the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. Thank you.
time of mourning. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God."
The tomb. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The woman who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes. But they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment.